Fellow Trek Chatters, I'm Pit Trekkie, and welcome to another episode of Pittsburgh's Trek Chat. So it has been exactly 5 months since my last video, and here's the reason for it. Well, actually, I think you can kind of see why I have not done videos in the last number of months. So on March 1st, I actually moved my mental health private practice to my own building. So I am now completely alone and renting my own space 100%. It's been quite a lot of work with all the moving and getting the insurances switched around, things like that. So it's been quite an interesting journey, quite a busy journey, which is why I haven't been able to record. But now I'm actually in a good spot to start bringing videos back again, and it's the perfect time for it anyway, considering that Star Trek Prodigy finally came back with its second season, now on Netflix, on July 1st. So what I would like to do in this episode of bringing back my videos is to review episode 1 of season 2 of Star Trek Prodigy. Just got to jog my memory real quick. Into the Breach Part 1 is the name of this first episode. So basically what happens is we see where our five crew members from season 1 are. We see that they're trying to work on becoming Starfleet cadets at this point. Janeway contacts the five of them, so that's what? That's Dahl, Murph, Rock, Zero, and Jankum, and asks them to come aboard a ship with her for a mission. So she sends the doctor, which was really nice to see Robert Picardo back in that role. He comes down, brings them aboard a shuttle to the Voyager-A. While they're on the route to the ship, they find out that they're supposed to be going on this mission to explore the wormhole that was created at the end of season 1 of Prodigy when they detonated the engines of the Protostar. So that's pretty much all the information that the doctor gives them at this point. They come aboard Voyager, they run across these cocky cadets from Nova Squadron real briefly, and they're kind of looking down on our cast of heroes. So basically, the doctor says they can't go aboard the bridge, but they're going to be assigned to different positions on the ship based on their interests, which they are. Dahl, at this point, we find out, is pretty bored with trying to get into the academy. He wants to have the adventure, and we knew that from season 1. He always was out there trying to have adventure, and he was just kind of, he didn't necessarily follow rules, he just kind of did what he needed to do on a whim. So the other four of them are basically saying, you know what, no, we got to start following rules and procedures so that we can get into the academy and be successful in our future lives. So they get aboard the ship, they're separated into their little areas, and we find out that Dahl is basically the only one who doesn't get to do anything that he's really interested in except the study. The doctor puts him in, it looks like some sort of crew quarters, and he ends up getting really upset about it. He contacts Gwyn. We find out that Gwyn has not reached Solem at this point. She's getting close, but she's kind of a little unsure about what it's going to be like when she gets there, because she's going to a planet that she really doesn't know. She's not really sure exactly what's going to happen. She has a little bit of a talk with Dahl about his boredom right now, and basically a little bit about temporal mechanics, because he's a little confused about how they're supposed to be looking to find Captain Chakotay 52 years in the future, and he's wondering about how the timeline is going to be changed, things of that nature. All right, but we find out through Zero and the doctor that Dahl's worries that there seems to be something hidden on board the ship, that Janeway and the rest of the crew seems to be hiding information. He doesn't understand why Janeway brought the five of them aboard, but then is completely blowing them off at this point. He thinks something's suspicious about this. And we kind of find out, the rest of the four feel like, oh no, there's nothing really going on. You know, it's just part of the crew, and we're just a part of this mission. Well, while in sickbay, Zero and the doctor are having a really nice conversation about being corporeal. Janeway contacts the doctor, and the doctor slips up. He says that he needs to go to Shuttle Bay 3, but he quickly corrects himself and says, no, Shuttle Bay 2. There are only two shuttle bays on board the new Voyager. So Zero realizes that this must mean something is up, because he even says the Doctor is not a good actor, which I thought was kind of an interesting nod to how great the Doctor thought he was in terms of being an actor on board during Voyager. But anyway, so Zero goes to Dahl and says, hey, something really is going on here. We need to investigate it. So they kind of get the rest of the group of them together, and Rock seems to be the really only one who doesn't want to kind of figure out what's going on. She wants to play by the rules and get into the academy. Well, eventually the five of them sneak into the Jeffries tubes, and they find out the Shuttle Bay 3 is basically just some sort of retroactive, like, cargo bay or something that they find. They go into this cargo bay kind of area, and they don't really see anything going on. Dahl decides to kick some loose piece of pipe or whatever, and it goes against what looks like what is a cloaked ship, which we find out is the Infinity. They're trying to figure out why the Infinity is cloaked, considering that cloaking technology is illegal in the Federation. So we find out Janeway and a couple of her experienced Starfleet crew around her, or entourage basically, they come in there. Our heroes are hiding up on the ceiling and are almost caught by Murph's drool, that's basically you can say it is. But basically what happens is we find out that the Infinity is supposed to be some sort of ship to go and not explore the wormhole. We find out that the wormhole has pretty much been explored, but Admiral Jellicoe is in charge of this mission where apparently they're supposed to go with the Infinity to go and find Captain Chakotay lost 52 years into the future. And right now he's shutting down that mission because he's worried about changes to the timeline. Now, Janeway is willing to bend this if she absolutely has to, but her Tellarite and Andorian officers that are with her are basically feeling that this is ridiculous. How can you go along with Admiral Jellicoe's suggestion? Captain Chakotay means something to you. We have to go on this mission. And they're willing to drop whatever it takes to follow her orders. And she says, we're not going there yet. That's basically a last option. And so they walk out of there, and that's basically where the episode ends at this point for part one. Now, here's what I'm going to say about my videos for the reviews of the next 20 episodes of season 2 of Prodigy. Every time I do a video, I am not going to go ahead and watch the season and then just go back and review the episode. So many of you have probably watched already the episode, all 20 episodes. Some of you are probably already into your second watch. Some of you have already probably watched the whole thing two or three times. But I'm going to go one-on-one. So every time I do a new video, it's going to be an actual reaction of, like, I'm curious what's going to happen next. So you guys might be ahead of me. That's fine. But I'm just doing this kind of to show my excitement as it goes on. So here's some of the things that I really liked about the episode. First of all, I really love that we got a brand new Voyager. I think that that's wonderful. I think it's a really nice looking ship. Lamar class, that's a very interesting name. I wonder where the name Lamar comes from for Lamar class. A lot of the names for some of the classes anymore I don't really understand, like Crossfield class, things like that. It's a nice name. I have no problem with it. I'm just curious where they came up with that name. But anyway, it looks like a pretty nice ship. It kind of looks like a melding of like the Enterprise E and the Enterprise F and a little bit of Voyager kind of all combined is the way it looks to me. But we got to know a little bit about the Lamar class. It can carry 800 crew members. It's got 29 decks, 16 holodecks. That's quite an upgrade from the two holodecks that the original Voyager had. And we see we have a Cetacean Ops, which is really cool. We've heard through Star Trek history that the Enterprise D supposedly had one, and we know the Cerritos from Lower Decks has one. So I'm sure we're going to be seeing a lot more of Cetacean Ops and what it's for and what it can do going in throughout the rest of this season. But I think it's nice to have a new ship, and obviously having the Voyager canon going on with the Registry and the A on board is really, really nice. Alrighty, so we know that there's currently a new mission, but we don't know the exact details of it. So we know that officially Voyager is supposed to be going and exploring this new wormhole that leads into the Delta Quadrant. And we know that Captain Chakotay's transmission or distress signal came from 52 years into the future in that. All we know at the beginning of the episode is that they're supposed to be observing the wormhole at this point. But we find out that there is a secret mission going on, and actually it's not even that the Voyager crew knows what's going on. It's only those few officers with Janeway that really know the actual mission and that they're actually being able to keep this mission secret from the rest of the Voyager crew and our heroes, obviously, who aren't even cadets at this point yet. So we're going to have to see what happens. Are Janeway and her people going to go on this mission? My guess is they're definitely going to go on the mission, and somehow our heroes are going to either sneak on board the Infinity or... You know, or maybe somehow Janeway's going to catch on that they know, and maybe she's secretly going to send them to save face for her and the rest of her crew. Who knows? It's going to be interesting to see how that all goes. All right. So, what I really loved also is seeing where all of our heroes, basically, at this point, are being positioned on board the ship. For Pog, we see that he's in engineering, and that's something that we find out about the Voyager-A as well. It's got a quantum slipstream warp core. So that's going to be great. Obviously, they didn't just throw that in there, and it's not going to be used. We're going to see that slipstream going and being used at some point during this season, without a doubt. So obviously, it's nice to see that Pog is going to be involved in engineering. Murph gets to go into one of these 16 holodecks to actually learn security training. It's kind of interesting that the security training starts with axes and spears in the holodeck. Kind of reminded me of Worf's calisthenics programs from back in the Next Generation day. Zero being in sick bay, I think obviously that fits. And we're going to get more into Zero and his little story in just a few minutes. Rock being in the cetacean ops, which I think is going to be very interesting to see. Because we know that Rock really loves animals, you know, biology. It's going to be great to kind of see her excitement, and we'll get to feel that through her. Because this is pretty much something new besides a little bit of viewing on lower decks. Who doesn't feel bad for Dahl at this point? He's the one who's the most adventurous of the crew, their little group, and he's the one who gets stuck in crew quarters being told he has to read about temporal mechanics 101. So no wonder that the character is bored, because he's right. He even said in the episode, he said, we used to be on the Protostar, we used to be on the bridge, we used to make our own decisions, we used to go on all these missions and explore new worlds, now we're stuck studying. The other characters seemed fine with that because it's getting them into the academy, which they all want, which Dahl wants as well, but he wants a little adventure on top of it. I guarantee they're all going to be on the bridge with Janeway at some point during the season. There's no denying that. All right. So some other things that I really liked about the episode. One of the things I really loved was the interaction with Zero and the Doctor. It started very early on in the episode before the Doctor even showed up, where... he saw the corporeal, the two cadets touching each other and kind of trying to thinking a little bit about what physical love, physical touch is. And can you imagine what that would be like, being non-corporeal and not being able to feel anything? All Zero can really do is just kind of read into the minds of other people, which we saw also at the beginning of the episode. So to actually have him kind of, the touchstones of him kind of learning about what it's like to feel and kind of be humanoid from the Doctor, I think is a beautiful tie back to what the Doctor was like on Voyager. Remember, the Doctor started out as non-corporeal as well. He had no feelings. Besides, he had emotions, but he didn't have any physical touch, anything that he really could do. So he kind of learned how to be humanoid, if not human, from Kes, from an Okompan. And then he ends up becoming, just from those years of learning from her, he learns how to teach 7 of 9 about what it means to be human or humanoid and regain her humanity. That's carrying on now, and I guarantee you that's going to be a story plot that goes on between the Doctor and Zero as the season moves on. And I think that's really nice how the Doctor even said, we all have the ability to grow beyond our original programming. Beautiful tie into everything that he had experienced during his time aboard Voyager. So there's going to be a nice connection there. And who knows, maybe they'll find a way for Zero to get some sort of tactile feeling or connection as the season goes on. I mean, heck, the Doctor was able to upgrade his program during the time of Voyager, even to the point where he was able to enjoy sex. You know, I mean, he made an addition to his program, let's be honest. Okay, so he's been able to grow. Maybe they'll find a way for Zero to grow as well. All right, who didn't love the little bit of Voyager music cues that showed up when the Voyager-A shuttle showed up and then they finally reached Utopia Planitia in the space dock for the Voyager-A? I thought that was a wonderful little touch. Obviously, they didn't use the theme itself, but nice little throwback. Just kind of like they did throwbacks with some of the older music from Star Trek history in Picard Season 3. Very, very nice. I also loved seeing Jankum Pog with another Tellarite, and the Tellarite actually, the Tellarite officer trying to argue with Pog. Remember, that wasn't him, for Tellarites, that's not being insulting, that's actually the way that they communicate and actually show, like, kindness. That's the way they communicate in Tellarite society. So, but it was interesting watching Pog trying to fight that and trying to gain his composure. Very interesting. I also like the fact that between Jankum Pog and that other Tellarite officer, you see kind of where you see a little bit of kind of the old Tellarite makeup from the original series and from Enterprise without the tusks, but you also see some of the updated Tellarite makeup with the tusks in Janeway's officer. Very nice little touch where there's still that little difference. It's not all of them now having that tusks. And by the way, and I know I've seen this in Picard, or not Picard, but Lower Decks and also in Prodigy Season 1. I love that they're not using the updated makeup of the Andorians when they're showing the Andorians in Prodigy and also in Lower Decks. I think that all those ridges and things that they added to the Andorians from Discovery and Strange New Worlds looks ridiculous, and there was absolutely no reason to upgrade the makeup. It looked perfectly fine. If they were going to keep any upgraded makeup, why didn't they keep the antennas moving instead of adding all this bullshit that they didn't need to add? But anyway, that's just a little side note. I really enjoyed that. All right. Also, what I really seemed to like were some of the Easter eggs to past Star Trek. I know some fans don't like the member berries and stuff, but I don't mind Easter eggs as long as they're used appropriately. So obviously, at the beginning of the episode, when Rock, we're learning that she's kind of doing the xenobiology stuff to try to help get her into Starfleet Academy. And we see she's talking about that Lieutenant Larkin from that the trouble with Edwards, that short treks, where he started to cause some of the tribbles to be able to excessively breed through his human DNA. And she's basically saying right now that she was able to, she thinks she might be able to figure out how to stop that process. So that was a nice little tie-in to that moment. I already mentioned about Utopia Planitia. We know that the original Voyager got launched from Utopia Planitia because we saw that in one of the final episodes of Season 5. I can't remember the name of it, Relativity or something? Where 7 and 9 is jumping back and forth through time. So seeing Voyager-A being released from a very similar space dock, if not the actual space dock from Utopia Planitia, is really nice. We also get to hear about why the Janeway is in command of the Voyager-A. We find out because the fleet's pretty busy with the Romulan evacuation. We obviously know that's a tie-in to two Star Trek projects. Obviously, that was a big piece in Star Trek 09 with Romulus being destroyed by the Hove as supernova, but also in Star Trek Picard, where we find out that Picard left the Enterprise-E to be basically in command of the caravan that's rescuing the Romulans and evacuating Romulus before the new supernova hits. So nice little tie-in there. We find out that the Bullions have two hearts. Now, something tells me that was probably said in some sort of other Star Trek show, whether it be Next Generation, Deep Space Nine, Voyager, whatever. I can't remember off the top of my head. I mean, let's be honest, there have been hundreds of episodes of Star Trek now. I can't remember every single detail, even though I've been a fan for over 35 years. But if anything, it still is a nice little thing to learn about the Bullions, whether we have or haven't already, that they have two hearts. So very cool on that end. I also love the fact that we have yet another cloaked ship that's being used for some sort of secret Starfleet mission. And that ties in beautifully to Star Trek canon. So we obviously know from 7th season episode of Next Generation, the Pegasus, that it had an experimental cloak, which was an interphasic cloak. But we also find out from the Treaty of Alderaan that Starfleet is not supposed to have any cloaking technology. It's illegal in the Federation. Okay, and we see that kind of carried on into Star Trek Insurrection when we see the holo ship that's hidden through cloak for this covert mission to transport the Baku away from their home planet so the Sona could harness the metaphasic radiation from the planet's rings. So this is the third sneaky Federation starship that we've seen. Now, we don't know a whole lot about the Infinity except that it's some sort of experimental carrier. So I'm hoping that we learn a little bit more about it as the season goes on. Obviously, we're going to have to. They're going to use it to go through the wormhole, unless they find a way to take Voyager-A through it, but we'll see. So that's pretty much my review of this first episode of Season 2 of Star Trek Prodigy, Into the Breach, Part 1. I'll be honest with you, it got me really excited again. Some Star Trek excites me, some Star Trek nowadays doesn't. I've been very clear in past episodes that I am a canonista. So I know the canon hasn't always been particularly protected, but when I watched Discovery and Strange New Worlds and they changed story items and even just the visual stuff, it just pulls me out of the stories. So I'm not interested in Discovery and Strange New Worlds, which is the reason why I don't review them on this show. I can't get into them. They're too different to me. I don't hate them. I like them in their own right. Okay, if I see it as like a separate timeline, you're probably going to come and get mad at me for saying that. That's just how I see it. But when I watch things like Lower Decks, Prodigy, Picard Season 3, it feels like it's part of the prime timeline, like it's supposed to be. And so I felt immersed in that Star Trek world again that I grew up with, you know. So go ahead, say that makes me less of a Star Trek fan or that makes me some sort of boomer. You know, go ahead with the ageist comments. But that's how I feel, and that makes me no different of a Star Trek fan than anybody else. We all love Star Trek for our own reasons, and whether you guys accept it's all one big happy thing or there's too much difference, we're all one big united Star Trek family. We're all fans. So I'm just going to leave it at that. But what are your thoughts about this first episode of Star Trek Prodigy Season 2? I can't wait to see if any of you have any comments. I'd love to hear from you and have you put them in the comments. I'll respond. Obviously, to watch this channel or watch any of my previous episodes, just go to youtube.com, type in Pittsburgh's Trek Chat in the search engine, and it'll take you directly to my channel and all my other episodes from the past. You can also follow the show on facebook.com/Pittsburgh's Trek Chat. You can also follow the show on X at PGH Trek Chat. Looking forward to the next episode and reviewing episode 2 of season 2 of Prodigy for you. And until then, may yins live long and prosper.